Now we come to the types of solution. Okay, so we come to the types of solution, and depending on which quantity is present in the bulk, whatever is present more, that is called solvent, and that which is present in a smaller quantity is called solute. That is the general definition. Normally what happens, normally what happens is we have been told that what remains in our mind is we have water and we put say sugar into it, so sugar becomes solute and water is solvent. Gradually I have seen this impact remains on our mind, and we feel that everything that is solute is a solid. That is wrong. That is not correct. Fine. So the solutions may be the gaseous solution. Now if it is gaseous solution, but then the quantity of sugar has to be more. So it will be kind of a wet sugar rather than any this thing. It will be just kind of a moisturized sugar that you'll have. Okay, so gaseous solution here. Type of solution and the solute is this and the solvent is this and the example is this. Okay, so we start with the gaseous solution. Okay, what is the solvent? Gas. Now we are free to vary our solutes, right? So our solute can be gas or liquid or solid. Okay, here the solvent remains the same, the gas. An example of a solute being a gas and a solvent being a gas is
air,
in which you can say that nitrogen is the solvent and oxygen or helium or carbon dioxide, they are solutes, right? So example is oxygen in air. We have liquid in gas.
Humid air.
Huh?
Humid air.
Yes, you can say humid air. Yeah. Okay. Or
the book writes chloroform. See, there are certain. Or you can say perfume in air. Okay.
These are volatile liquids. Okay. So what happens? They become vapor even at room temperatures. So suppose you apply perfume, you put on perfume, what happens? It actually evaporates and mixes in the air so uniformly after some time, obviously. The moment you do that, then what happens? Say if it's on your clothes or on your hand or the back of your ear, wherever you apply it. So what happens for that moment, the molecules which are present here in the air, that is more than the molecule maybe at the end of the room. Only after sufficient time has elapsed, then only it gets diffused throughout uniformly. Fine? Then too, if you see, then around the place where it has been applied, there it is. It is in more quantity, okay? Because that's why if you come, say, closer to someone who is wearing perfume, what happens? You feel it more. The smell is more. The odor is more. And solid in gas is?
Dust particles in air
are not solution. Why dust particles in air are not solution? Because the solution should not break. You understand? It's a suspension. A solution should not break. What do I mean by breaking? That means if that air is left around for some time, then the dust should not settle. This is what you call breaking of a solution, breaking of so then it becomes a suspension. Fine? Because there is also a restriction on the size of the particles inside the solution. Fine? Different books give you different thing, but normally it is less than 1 nanometer, it is solution. Okay? And 1 to 1000 is colloid, and beyond that is suspension. Fine? So a solid in this, anything that sublimes, okay, camphor in air. Okay? Ultimately what happens, camphor in air also becomes a gas, because from solid it straight away goes to gas. Fine? But still, since it had come from solid, no, it won't be broken. The perfume, no. The camphor will not kind of settle down. It becomes so small particles that it does not settle. Okay? Now we come to liquid solution. So, immediately the moment you say that it is liquid, it means that the solvent is liquid, and this can again be three. So it could be gas, it could be liquid, it could be odonil is also camphor like, no, it sublimes
solid in gas,
solid to gas. So gas, liquid, solid. Here it is liquid. Gas in liquid?
Water. Water, oxygen.
Soft drinks, right? What happens? This is CO2 in water. Oxygen in water. Oxygen has got water has got oxygen molecules trapped in it, because if that was not possible, then no marine life would have been possible, right? So you can say gas and liquid. So oxygen in water, liquid in liquid. What do you call two liquids which dissolve in one liquid that dissolves in the other in all proportions? That is called a liquid that dissolves in other liquid in all proportions is called a miscible liquid. Okay? Soluble is something else, miscible is something else. Solubility or soluble means it is soluble up to an extent. Okay, up to an extent it is soluble, beyond that it might not be. Fine? So one of the things that actually completely mixes with water is ethanol. So ethanol in water is a solution. Okay.
And then anything else, solid in liquid is maybe sugar in water, or maybe salt in water. Fine.
That is a liquid solution. Fine. Then we come to a solid solution. So here again I know that this is solid, solid, solid. This is gas. This is liquid. This is solid. Gas in solid. Now we'll, when we do our organic, then we'll come to know that that palladium, we'll also be doing the P block elements. Palladium is a P block element. Palladium, nickel, platinum. And when we do surface chemistry, we understand that there is a kind of bonding between the hydrogen and many other gases and these P block elements. Why? Due to the free bonds that still remain. So they have a tendency to get attached to it and spread on the surface. Fine. So many of the, why many? All of the hydrogenation reactions that we'll be seeing, they will have one of these palladium, nickel or platinum and hydrogen gas. Okay. So hydrogen gas spreads over it so that its surface area becomes very, very large, and then it is capable of reacting. The rate of reaction becomes very, very, very fast, and that's why they are termed as catalysts. Because what has palladium or nickel or platinum done? It has itself not participated in the reaction. It has only facilitated the increase in rate of reaction, right? So maybe hydrogen gas on nickel. Look, it is a solution only at the surface. You should understand that. If you go into the bulk of palladium, it is no longer a solution. So hydrogen gas on nickel at the surface of it. Okay, this has to be understood. It has to be at the surface. Then we have liquid and solid. That also we'll study in some detail. Amalgam. Whenever you say amalgam, it inevitably involves mercury, right? So amalgam of mercury, say with sodium, they bind together.
Can't it be sponge dipped in water?
Sponge, no. Sponge dipped in water will not be there. The sizes are too big. Those pores are too big to be called a solution. And solid in solid is?
Alloy.
An alloy. Any alloy, say. It could be alnico, it could be iron with carbon. Okay? Carbon is mixed in iron to increase its hardness. But in the process, the steel starts becoming brittle. It also starts becoming brittle. So all the alloys, okay? So maybe nickel in iron, nickel in iron, or copper in gold. When you mix copper, and you normally mix copper in gold, to make it hard, because otherwise 24 karat gold is too soft to be converted into any jewelry, and it'll lose its shape very, very fast. So normally you mix copper into it, and starts becoming from 24 karat, it starts becoming 23 and 22, and okay. If you increase the content of copper a lot, then the gold, instead of looking yellowish, it starts looking copperish, okay? It starts looking reddish like copper. And the trend nowadays in market is to call it rose gold, okay? They call it rose gold, and many of the very high-end watches that are made, they are, you'll find written rose gold. Rolex watches, you'll find written rose gold. It's made in rose gold. It means that the gold percent is somewhere around 20 to 25%, or maybe less, and it's mostly copper. Fine. And it gives you a different kind of hue. So it gives you a copper, yellowish copper kind of look, and they call it rose gold.
Robust steel.
CRGS. CRGS is also an alloy. CRGS, yes. It's an alloy. CRGOSS, cold rolled, grain oriented silicon steel that we studied in physics, and we use it as core of transformers and machines and motors and generators. Okay, that is also an alloy. Fine.